I guess signal processing and digital signal processing today is a rather mature discipline. So it's very well established, and there are no fundamental questions, at least as far as the core signal processing competences are concerned.
This is Paolo Prandoni, a senior researcher at EPFL.
But of course, as I said before, signal processing is a discipline that expands and intertwines with so many other disciplines all the time, so there's always new challenges.
Let's discuss current challenges that signal processing is facing.
I think from the technical point of view, perhaps the two big questions today in signal processing are how do we sample signals? So as I said before, we want to bring the outside world into our computers. And the way we do that, everybody knows this, is by just measuring the signals very quickly in time. We hear about, I don't know, the compact disc has 44.1 thousand samples per second. That means that we measure our music signals 44,000 times per second, but very regularly in a very fine and equally spaced grid. But perhaps there are better ways to do that. Maybe non-uniform sampling techniques can actually give us a better digital representation of our signal.
In fact, biology seems to be telling us to do so.
There's evidence that says that, for instance, the way the human body looks at things, so scans, for instance, the visual landscape, is via non-uniform sampling techniques. So this is one open question. There's a lot of work in that domain.
And indeed, it seems quite natural to augment the sampling frequency when a lot of things is happening so as not to miss anything interesting. And conversely, it seems relevant to reduce the sampling frequency when not much is going on so as to save memory or battery.
Another big question is with respect to multidimensional signal processing. So we're very good at dealing with simple signals that evolve over time. These are one-dimensional signals. You have one quantity that moves over time, and we can do really pretty much anything we want with these signals. Then you can go up one dimension and you have two-dimensional signal processing. This is also known as image processing. We're a bit less good, but we're making progress. But of course, there's a lot of systems that produce information that is multidimensional, three, four, five dimensions. And for these problems, there's a lot of techniques that have to be designed.
Wait, I can imagine a three-dimensional signal, but what would be an example of a six or seven-dimensional signal?
For instance, think about, we're here in this room, and if you had an artificial eye that you can put at any point in the room and capture the entire visual situation around you, well, that is a function of seven variables, because you have the three-dimensional position of this eye, and this eye can also look in different direction, which adds another 2 degrees of freedom. And then, of course, you have the color, so the wavelength of the light, and that's six dimension, and then you have the fact that the scene changes because we're moving, so you have a seventh dimension this time. Okay, so if you were to perfectly capture, say, for a virtual reality application, the entire landscape in this room, you'd have to capture a seven-dimensional function, which is an enormous amount of data, and it's not clear today how to deal with this very, very large data sets.
In fact, if you combine plenty of different measurements of the same event, you'll quickly get to very high-dimensional signals. And as we've already discussed it with Michael Kaprilov, we don't yet have a very good understanding of how to process such high-dimensional signals.
Then there's another problem with signal processing, which I think is a little bit philosophical, but it's interesting. So today what we're having is an ever-growing importance of things like machine learning, deep learning. And these techniques put signal processing in a bit of a identity crisis.
An identity crisis?
Take speech recognition, for instance, right? So you have, I'm talking to you and you want a machine that is able to understand what I'm saying. And what I'm producing is a speech signal, and we can sample this signal, we can make it digital, and then you have your machine that has all these samples that come in, maybe, you know, 16,000 samples per second. And it's a lot of data, and it's a lot of processing that needs to be done in order to convert this sound samples into a string of words. And what signal processing was very good at was to devise pre-processing techniques. So a set of filters and circuits or algorithms that somehow replicated, say, the way our ears work. And these circuits were designed to provide what is called a data dimensionality reduction. So you go from a lot of data in real time to just a few important parameters that they can use to try to recognize speech.
And for a long time, such techniques were the state of the art. But
now what happens is that we have such enormous computing ability, especially the likes of Google and Facebook, that it has become convenient to just take the raw data and throw the data directly into things that are called a deep convolutional network, for instance. And these big networks, with their enormous computing power and enormous data sets that they can be trained on, basically don't need this pre-processing anymore. You know, they just can process the raw data and seem to outperform all these very carefully crafted systems that we did in the past. So there's a lot of signal processing engineers today say, well, what are we here? What are we doing? You know, if this network can do our process better than us. But I think it's a false problem, because in reality, this deep convolutional networks, they work very, very well. But paradoxically, no one really understands why they work so well. And trying to understand what the training does, what the neural network has converged to, is, in a sense, a signal processing problem, the same way they say understanding how the human brain works by looking at neural pathways is a signal processing problem. So I think there's still a lot of work to be done in signal processing, in spite of the fact that, yes, sometimes deep learning techniques are a little bit better than what we do with pencil and paper, yeah.
In fact, even if signal processing has been outperformed by deep learning for some AI tasks, there's definitely still a lot of insights to be gained by using signal processing techniques.
I think signal processing is really a lot of fun. I think I fell in love with it when I first studied, when I was a student, and it never really fails to show how pervasive it is. And I think that some people say that there are no jobs in signal processing today. So some people perhaps are a little bit skeptical to pick up a career in signal processing. But I think it's because so many jobs that are signal processing jobs are not necessarily labeled as signal processing jobs. And I think that basic knowledge in signal processing is absolutely necessary in pretty much any scientific career that someone can pick up these days. And if you don't study signal processing in university, then you know you will have to study on your own later on, because there's no escaping its usefulness. Yes.
Signal processing algorithms processes and extracts information from data, while machine learning algorithms recognize patterns and make recommendations.
Usually you look at data in time as it evolves, but you can just flip the perspective of your viewpoints and look at the same data from the point of view of frequencies.